Morning. Welcome to the flight International Space Station Flight Control Room in the Mission Control Center in Houston. I'm Brandy Dean. I'm Public Affairs Officer here, and I've got here with me Gary Cox, who is the EPIC Project Manager. That's a station computer upgrade project that he's been working on, so he knows a lot about the station's computers. And here we've got some questions from students in Georgia that we're going to try and answer.
When you're giving tasks to the astronauts and cosmonauts, how do you go about doing that? Do you just tell them, or is there a specific order that you have to do it?
I'm sorry, can you repeat the question? When we get tasks that we have to go through, is that what you said?
Yes, ma'am. When you're giving tasks to the astronauts and cosmonauts, is there a specific way you have to go about doing that?
Okay, that's probably a great question for Gary. He just got finished giving the astronauts a really complicated task about upgrading the station's computer, so he can tell us a little bit about how that works.
Sure. There's a lot of training and rehearsal that goes on prior to the mission or the task that's actually asked to be completed. Oftentimes, we write procedures on papers and send files up to the space station computers to allow the astronauts to read what their next task has to be, and then they follow these procedures as they perform the task itself. And there's a lot of communication as well between the ground system people here and the crew up on board.
So we give them a detailed instruction list, basically, right?
Right, a detailed instruction list, and there's a lot of training that happens beforehand to make sure they understand what they're going to be doing once they're up there.
And I guess even when we do need to talk to them, we have a special person in the Mission Control Center that talks to them, and they get training just to talk to the crew. So there's a lot that goes into getting ready to do something.
And all this happens before the astronauts even launch into space. A lot of this training is occurring on the ground before they get up there. They already know what they're going to be working on.
Right, okay. So does that answer your question?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. I want to ask, what is the closest thing we have found to life on Mars currently?
Closest thing we found to life on Mars. Well, we've got some really cool rovers that are on Mars right now and looking for signs of life on Mars. And I think, let's see, they've maybe found signs of water. Is that right?
Yeah, found signs of water, ice, and some evidence of where there was flowing water and ice, which could lead you to believe there might be something there. But right now, they just finding the basics at this point.
So no little green aliens yet.
Yeah, nothing yet.
Is it hard for astronauts to go to sleep in space?
Is it hard for astronauts to what in space?
Sleep.
To sleep.
To sleep?
Yes.
Okay. I think they work really hard, so they are probably pretty sleepy at the end of the day, but they do have to do some special stuff to be able to sleep, because without gravity holding you down to the bed, then you just float away. So they've got kind of special sleeping bags.
Sleeping bags, right.
Right, that are attached by Velcro, I think, to the space station's walls, so they don't float away, and they've got a special pillow that they kind of strap their head onto so that they can rest like they do at home.
What's the main goal for the Space Center for the year 2012-2013?
The main goal for the Space Center for 2012 and 2013?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, well, we've got a few different goals that we're working on. Of course, the big one is always to keep the space station and its crew safe, because we've got a lot of really cool experiments that are going on up there that we definitely want to get good information from. So that's always the big one. But we've also got a lot of cool new projects that we're working on as well that we're going to use to go further out into space. So we're doing a lot of interesting work with that, too.
What processes do you have to go through to send a rover to different planets?
I'm sorry, can you repeat that one a little louder?
Hey guys, you may want to stand up, and the microphone is right beside the projector, so if you could kind of speak towards that microphone, they can hear you a little bit better.
Right there. Okay. What processes do you go through to send a rover to different planets?
What processes do we go through to send a rover to the planet? Okay. Well, there's a lot of work that goes into sending anything into space. And I haven't personally sent a rover to a planet. We don't really do that here at Johnson Space Center because we send astronauts to the space station and we've sent them to the moon, of course. But yes. Gary can maybe talk about what goes into that.
It's a long process. I mean, a lot of coordination has to happen. You have to be able to design the rover that's going to work in that environment that you're going to, that planet that you're going to be putting this rover onto. You have to find a launch vehicle that will take the rover to it for you. There's a lot of planning and coordination that has to happen many, many years in advance of that. A lot of times when you do send rovers to these other planets, it takes months or years to actually arrive there as well. So there's a lot of foresight, a lot of, again, planning that takes in order to coordination to get that accomplished.
Like right now, we actually here in Houston are working on a rover for people to stay in when they go to, say, the Mars or an asteroid that they will live in for a few weeks at a time as they're exploring. So right now we've got a version that we're using here on the ground to try and test out, where do the windows need to be so that you can really see what you need to see as you're exploring and how is it going to be controlled and all sorts of things. So you've got to look at every little detail before it actually goes into space.
How many projects are being done at the Space Center as of now?
How many projects? I don't know that we have an exact number on hand, but it's a lot. We've got thousands of people working just here at Johnson Space Center, and there are 10 NASA centers across the country, so there are lots and lots of projects going on right now.
How many people usually work in mission control?
How many people work in mission control? It kind of depends on what you count. We've got a lot of people that work here in the front room that we're in right now are the ones who you usually see on TV a lot. But behind the scenes, there's a whole lot of other people working in the same building to do some of the behind the scenes work. And I don't know, Gary.
Right. We have other rooms similar to this room, and we have some that perform many of the same tasks and duplication of tasks to help the people up here in front be ready for any occurrence of any issues or anything. They help them be ready for that. So we have a lot of folks in different rooms in this building supporting the people up here.
And it also depends on the kind of the time of day and things like that. So there are a lot of different factors, but a lot more than you would think.
Where would you say where astronauts usually train at?
Where do they train?
Where do astronauts train?
Yes, ma'am.
They train right here in Johnson Space Center, for one thing. They get trained in a lot of places, but they actually live and work here in Houston. And I think Gary's been involved with training them for some of the work we were talking about earlier with the station's computers, so maybe you can talk about that.
Right. We have a facility here in Houston that has what we call mock-ups. They look like the space station. There are actual modules on the ground that the astronauts can train as if they were in space. We also have some in this giant swimming pool where they can act like they can train as if they're in space. They're floating around inside the pool. So we have different facilities here at Johnson Space Center that allow them to train and get ready for their task when they get on board.
How many computers do you have in mission control, and does a certain computer get a certain task, or do all the computers work on the same task or something like that?
Do you want to take that one?
I don't know a number of how many computers. There's many, many computers. We have rooms full of computers that help us manage the vehicle. We have a lot of data that comes down from the vehicle itself that's processed here on the ground. Many, many different rooms with different computers, different ways to look at the data. All of them are doing different tasks in many cases. Here in the front room, all these computers that you see on the television have access to all the data. So anybody can see anything pretty much they want to see at any one time. But we have a lot of computers, a lot of computing power here.
I think there's at least two just behind me right here, and that's just one little part of this room of mission control, and there's lots of rooms, and they all have lots of computers.
What are the effects of astronauts going into space on their human body?
What are the effects of astronauts going into space on the human body?
Correct.
Okay, well, that's one of the things we're studying with the International Space Station. What we want to learn is exactly how living in microgravity affects human bodies, so that when we want to send them further out and they're way longer, we know how to deal with them and be ready to fix them if we need to. So one of the things that we know happens is that when you don't have to use your muscles because you're just floating around all day, you start to lose muscle mass. And so one of the things we do is we keep the astronauts working and exercising while they're in space. They have to exercise so much each day, and they've got a bunch of really interesting, cool equipment that they use to do that on the space station. Ways that they are able to pretend like they're running on a treadmill, even though if they were just running on a regular treadmill, they'd float up, and that wouldn't help. They've got tethers that hold them down, and then they've got things that help them kind of act like they're lifting weights in space, right. And an exercise bicycle too.
What type of degree do you have to work in mission control?
What kind of degree do you have to have? Why don't you talk about that?
Mostly the science degrees are what you were looking for, science and engineering. I have electrical engineering degree, so electronics, aerospace is another good type of degree to get, computers. But very technical degrees are the key ones to look at.
Anything in science or technology or math is usually a good bet, but not everybody does. I have a journalism degree because I write things, so there are a bunch of different things we can use.
Right.
Does equipment ever break down while in orbit, and if so, how do they fix things?
Equipment definitely breaks down, and Gary might be able to talk about that a little bit with the computers.
Yeah, we do have to make sure we maintain the vehicle to make sure things don't. When they do break down, we have limitations because, you know, we don't have all the tools that we have on the ground to go in there to make modifications. So the first thing we have to do is try to prevent the thing from breaking down. And the upgrade project we just did is one of those things we've done. We try to upgrade and keep the equipment modern or up to date so that we don't have to worry about it breaking down. But once it does, we have to get the crew involved, heavily involved in trying to help repair the equipment on board. We have a lot of spares up there, so if one computer breaks down, we can take a spare up there and that's already up there and install it and keep the space station operating.
Okay, so how has the government affected the Space Center?
Say that one again.
How has the government affected the Space Center?
How has the government affected the Space Center? Well, the Space Center is part of the government. We're a federal agency, so we are part of the government, and we get our money, our budget from the U.S. government. So that affects everything we do. Everything from, you know, how many rockets we can send into space to how many computers we can work on, all of that sort of thing. So it's all very much interconnected.
Do you plan to send rovers to any other planet than Mars?
Do we plan to send rovers where?
To any other planet than Mars.
Other
planet other than Mars.
To other planets other than Mars. Okay. We actually have flying rovers that are already going all over the solar system, and you can find out about a lot of them on NASA.gov if you want to take a look. But I think, yeah, that we definitely want to do that.
How do you keep satellites from ramming into each other during the time period that they're in space?
I'm sorry, we can't hear you very well. Oh, did you hear that?
Yeah.
I think Gary got it. Go ahead.
Yeah, how do you keep satellites from hitting one another in space?
Correct.
Right. So we have a monitoring system here on Earth where we monitor all the satellites that are orbiting the Earth itself, including Space Station as just another big satellite. And we understand and can map their locations every day, every moment of the day, so we know where they are. And each satellite has a way of maneuvering in space. You can fire a little jet engine on that satellite to make it move out of the way. And a lot of the pre-planning happens before the satellite's launched to make sure it's going to go into a location in space that won't interfere with anybody else.
How will some of the scientific research done on board the space station help people living on Earth?
Okay, well, there are lots of different types of research going on the International Space Station right now. So there are lots of different ways that could be affecting Earth. But, for instance, you know, one of the things we talked about earlier was how space affects astronauts and how they have to exercise. Another thing that we found out that that astronauts tend to experience when they've been in space for a long time is they start to lose bone density. And that's also something that is a problem for people who are confined to bed rest here on the Earth. So things that... That we can figure out to do for astronauts to help them combat that can also be used here on Earth to help people who are confined to bed rest also avoid bone density loss. And that's just one way. There are a bunch of different experiments going on that all have lots of different uses here on the Earth.
When is the next time you're going to send an astronaut, like to the moon or to a different planet?
Well, we're still working on the systems that would help us go to an asteroid or Mars or a moon, things like that. But we send astronauts into space all the time. We've got 6, you probably know, living at the International Space Station right now. And in a few months, 3 of them will come home, and then we'll send up 3 more. So we keep people in space all the time. And there's been somebody in space for more than 10 years now.
What is your most efficient fuel for shuttles?
The most efficient fuel for a shuttle?
Yes.
Well, I think it depends on the kind of engines you have as to what fuel you use. But one of the things we're looking at here at Johnson Space Center is how we can use what we're calling kind of green fuels, things that aren't bad for the environment to fuel rockets, and things that also we could find, say, if we went to Mars or the moon, things that we could find there that we could use to fuel the rockets as well, so that we could not have to carry all of our fuel into space, because it takes a lot of fuel to get any amount of weight into space. You want to weigh as little as possible. So if we can carry less fuel, then we can get into space easier. And then if we can get the fuel, more fuel where we're going, then that makes it easier to get into space.
What do astronauts do for fun up there in space?
I'm sorry, we didn't hear that one.
What do astronauts do for fun up in space?
What do astronauts do for fun up in space? Well, they've got a lot of things they can do. They actually are connected to the internet, and they blog, and they send down tweets, and they can watch movies and read books. And
they can also talk to their families on the ground with these laptop computers that they have. They can have video conferences with their families in their free time.
Maybe y'all have done that before, had a video chat with your computer. They can do that in space, too.
Has space debris ever seriously messed up a satellite or something that was important you were trying to get into space?
Space debris? Did it ever mess up a satellite or anything important?
There have been some instances in the past, many years ago, where some satellites have actually collided. Yes.
And then they break up and they cause more space debris that we have to watch out for.
They break up and they do create more space debris that we have to worry about, and we track on a daily basis to make sure they don't interfere with anybody else.
We've got a lot of people keeping really close track on all the debris that's in space so that we can move the space station and other satellites around and make sure we avoid it.
Mm-hmm. What are the foods that astronauts eat to keep healthy and strong?
Food.
Astronauts' food? What do they eat? They have a lot of different things they can eat, but what we do is we send it up, we call it dehydrated. We take all the moisture out of it, and it looks kind of gross, but when they get on orbit, they have a special kind of kitchen that they hook it up to, and it puts hot water back into it to re-moisturize it, and then it tastes good. So they have a bunch of different choices. They've got American food and Russian food, and also when they have an international partner up there from Europe or Japan or Canada, they bring some food sometimes as well, so they have a wide variety, and they don't get so tired of eating the same thing over and over.
All right, thank you so much. And South Effingham, can you hear me at the Digital Learning Network?
Yes.
All right, looks like we're just about out of time for questions to Mission Control, but I wanted to thank Brandy and Gary for participating today and answering all these great questions. Brandy, would you like to say goodbye to the students at South Effingham Middle School?
Sure. Thank you all so much for your questions. We had a lot of fun talking with you. Right, Gary?
Yes, we did. Thank you.